Hello friends, thank you very much for joining this live event. We continue today our discussion with lesson number 48 on the synchronized keyword, and then we discuss about deadlocks, and afterwards we'll of course discuss about executor services if time allows us. So this is the plan for today. If you are watching the event live, don't forget that we have a live chat there, so you can ask me questions directly in the live chat. If you are watching the event recorded, you can still ask questions in the comment section, or you can find me on LinkedIn or Twitter and we can discuss there as well. So with that being said, let's start our today discussion with what remains to be discussed on synchronized, because synchronized is a subject that we have touched in the past couple of lessons. And this is the lesson where we'll end the discussion about synchronized as a keyword. We'll of course maybe use synchronized in the next lessons and the future examples as well, but we say end the discussion on synchronized, and then using synchronized I will teach you how a deadlock works, and basically we'll mostly discuss the very top of the mountain view about deadlocks, because deadlocks are quite complicated, and we'll not use a profiler today. That will be probably in one of the future lessons, but still we will discuss at least what you need to know, say for your OCP exam, and as said, then start discussing the high level frameworks, and we will start that subject with the executors. Let's go to my computer and start with working on this project. I have already created actually a project, but it's empty. And it uses, as usual, Java 14. That's less important. First of all, creating a new first example package just to prove you how the synchronized keyword works as a modifier for the method signature, and tell you what's different from using it with a block of code the way we have used it in the previous couple of lessons. And then we discuss about using synchronized on the interface level, which is quite important because, well, say that I had some issues with that a few years ago when I was using an implementation that was actually using some synchronized block of a third-party library. I will tell you the story later. And you need basically to know that. I hope that you will actually find that useful, and it will spare some of your time in the future when you will maybe work on something similar. So the first example one, and a first class. We're only discussing here syntaxes of the synchronized. We've already used it in an example in the past couple of lessons, and you already know how it looks like in a, say, real world scenario. So now we will just enhance your knowledge with a few more ways in which you can use synchronized, and I will make you the difference between them, because synchronized is itself and the synchronized block works similarly. So we don't change anything in the way synchronized works. It works the same as we discussed it in the past couple of lessons. You know, we've made that analogy with the police officer and the crossroads. So you can simply take it the same. I just show you a couple more syntaxes in which you can use the synchronized keyword, and that you need to know again for both real world scenarios as well as for your OCP exam, because you might find those syntaxes as well in the OCP exam. So if you don't know them, then of course you might answer wrongly some questions, and of course we don't want that. So with that being said, a class, example one, and just first of all I will create a method A, public void A, in which I'd like to remind you how we used the synchronized keyword in the past couple of lessons. You remember that we have used the synchronized keyword followed by the round parentheses and then the curly braces that hold the block of code that we synchronized, and you know that the value that should be between these round parentheses is the monitor, and then as a monitor you can use an object, and it can be any kind of object. So remember that any kind of object can be used as a monitor, but we discussed that it really matters which is the object that you use, because depending on that you will synchronize some block of codes one with the other. So like we did in the past couple of lessons where we used a producer-consumer approach and you synchronize the block from the producer with the block from the consumer. So depending on what you do, you will synchronize one or more a block of codes. So say in our case that we have here an object, it doesn't really matter for our situation because in our case basically again we don't implement a functionality, so I just want to have a syntax that compiles in the end. I will call this the monitor just for you to remind what this actually is and how we name it. And you know that this is basically the object holding the lock and is the object managing the threads inside the synchronized block. Again, as we discussed in the previous couple of lessons, I won't retake that discussion, but if you want to see it again, it's recorded, it's available on the same channel. Just take your time and analyze it as many times as you want. And if you still have questions, then of course leave me a comment or find me on LinkedIn or Twitter. So syntactically speaking, this was the syntax we've used. And again, you've learned, and for this I will actually create a method B. You've learned that you can even use basically the instance of the class itself. But as we discussed, using the instance of the class actually means that you synchronize the block and use the current instance as the monitor, which will affect the way you do the synchronization, because in this case you will only synchronize the threads that act on the instance itself. So again, it's a different object. You have just to visualize the object, and depending on what you want to implement, use a specific monitor. If you want to have a monitor for multiple blocks of code, then you cannot use this, because or you can use it, but only if it's inside the same class. You cannot use this for two different classes. So that's why. And as we discussed a couple of weeks ago, we couldn't use this object, the instance of the class for our example with the producer consumer, because in that case we wanted to synchronize the producer with the consumer. So we had two different classes. So we couldn't simply use this, because in that case we wouldn't synchronize correctly the two different kinds of threads. So that there were we decided to use only one monitor, the unique one that we had in the example, which was the list itself, the list, the collection, which was also the shared resource and the object in which we were changing by both producers and consumers. Now, what happens actually when we use the synchronized keyword on the method itself? Because, and now I will change my syntax back. What happens when you see a syntax like this? You use the synchronized keyword simply as a modifier on the method signature, where basically this simply means that the block of code of the method is synchronized. And the monitor, you see that there is no monitor here, so you don't see any object that acts on the synchronization. So if you use this syntax here, you might wonder where did the monitor go? Why don't you actually have a monitor in this case? Well, it turns out that you have a monitor, but it's just hidden. It's the instance of the class, because in this case, being that the method is a non-static one, so it's a behavior of the class. When you use synchronized on the method itself, it simply acts like a normal synchronized keyword where you synchronize the whole block of the method. So from the starting curly brace to the end curly brace of the method, like in this case, the synchronized keyword applies on this block of code. If you use it on the signature of the method as a modifier, you simply synchronize the whole block of the method. And the monitor that's hidden here, you don't see it, you don't have to specify it, automatically becomes this. So it's more or less equivalent to method B. Method C here is more or less equivalent, assuming that you don't put anything here, and after the synchronized block, you can say it's more or less similar to what we have here. But of course, there are important differences. If in case of method B, you add something here, or you add something here, then this is out of the synchronized block, so that part here, this one and this one, isn't synchronized, which means that if you have several instructions here or here outside of the synchronized block in the same method, those instructions still can be executed on parallel threads, so the threads won't wait at that point one after the other, while in this case, well, you have no chance, whole block of the method is synchronized, so you don't have any possibility of adding instructions that are all outside of the synchronized block. But again, what you have to remember is that it's basically, when you add synchronized here on the method, it simply means that the whole block of the method is synchronized, and then the monitor automatically becomes the instance of the class. So it's actually the same thing as using the monitor object this for a synchronized block, like I did in this case here. And the other specific syntax for using synchronized is, of course, using synchronized on the static method. And of course, in case of a static method, that's a little bit special, because if it's a static method, then you don't have this instance. Static means part of the class. It's not a behavior of an instance, as you have learned in the very first lessons of this fundamental stream. So you will see that you can actually use the synchronized keyword as well with static methods. And that's, again, it works similarly. But the difference is, of course, the monitor. So I have a question: how can threads execute here if monitor is this? Why would that be a problem to execute if the monitor is this? It's simply just a different object. You use this as the object as a monitor, so it doesn't affect anyway the synchronization. It works the same way as using any other object, but it's simply this. So the object is maybe I should give you an example somehow. Let me think, how can I actually do this? I will create a second package just to not mix the examples, and I will try to explain here what actually means to have this as an object. Say we have an object A, a class A, and then you have two methods, public void M1 and public void M2, and you have synchronized this, and it can be like the syntax we used here. Or you can have synchronized here on the method, which we just discussed that it means the same thing. Okay? So A and B. So what does this actually mean in this case is that an instance of the class itself, so say I create here example 2, and I create an instance of the class itself, this instance here is the one that acts as a monitor in both for both methods, for M1 and for M2, which actually means here that if you have a thread doing something, like in our case, you can actually simply create a thread here, as you have learned, override public void run, as you have learned, and then use a M1. So this is a thread T1 that I have created here, and you have a second thread T2 where you call M2. Okay, so in this case, being that both threads, when I start them, start and T2 start, both threads work with the same instance. So I hope you agree here that they basically do work with the same instance. In this case, it basically automatically became final because I'm in an anonymous class actually here. And I have created two threads very fast by simply customizing the thread class using an anonymous class. But the run method simply actually call here the M1 behavior of instance A and M2 behavior of instance A. So the question is, Are these threads actually synchronized, like the block of the code here and this block of code? Is it synchronized or is not synchronized? And it actually turns out that it is synchronized, because in both cases inside you have as a monitor you are using this. And in case of the two threads that you have here, this is in both cases the same instance. So being that it is the same instance, then it means that actually the two of them are synchronized one with the other, because both of them use the same monitor. So you have two synchronized blocks, but they use the same monitor. So using this is nothing special actually of using some other object. It's just that in some cases you cannot use it, because this is much more part of a specific instance. So in this case, for example, in my case, I use only one instance A, and that's why M1 and M2 really are synchronized one with the other. But if I would change this code now, and I will create two instances, an A and a B, and I change my code such that one of the threads call A and the other one calls B, then in this same example, is M1 synchronized with M2 anymore? And actually in this case it isn't, even though you use this, because this in this case for M1 will be instance of what was in the A variable when we called it, and then this one will be B here. So you need to be attentive when you refer to this, because this in the case of any method, the case of any method that can use this, which is a non-static method, is always the object from which you have referred to the method. And when you use this in both cases here, and maybe if you want to see it even better, we can put it like this and then you see it better. So in this case you use, basically it looks like both of them use the same monitor, but they don't use the same monitor. In this case the two threads are not synchronized one with the other, because for M1 this will take this instance here, while in the case of M2 this will take the other instance. So you have two different monitors. Okay, super. I'm glad it's clear. I didn't have this prepared, so that's why it took me a little bit of time to think of an example. But I hope that you understand what's important to understand actually about this is that when looking inside the class itself, you might see it as only one object, because you see the same thing here and the same thing here. But it turns out that in some cases it might be the same instance. Like in my case, if I use the same instance from where I refer to M1 and M2, then this really is the same instance. It will be the same one. But at the same time, using this doesn't offer you anyhow guarantee that you have the same instance, because it really depends how you use it from outside. If the threads use two different instances, you have two different monitors. If the threads use only one instance, then the code is synchronized. So, and that doesn't mean that you don't use this, but when you use it, you have to think about it and have in mind the way it works. And when you have the threads, knowing if two blocks of code are synchronized one with the other really matters on the instance from which you refer to the methods. Okay, thank you also for asking, and again great questions, and I hope this clarified the idea of having this. But in other words, again, it's only like using a normal object, because any object, even this in this case, which is always an object, can be a monitor. So when you use synchronized on the method, it simply is using the monitor this for this whole block of the method. So in our case, in example one, in example two here, where I've used A, I could have written it this way, or I could have completely removed this block and instead
because in any case here I have only one instruction which was synchronized. I just can use synchronized on the method itself. So it's the advantage is that it's a little bit easier to read, and basically it's not different in terms of having the block itself and only the block. But of course, remember that the synchronize block offers you also the flexibility of having inside the method also code that is outside of the synchronization. So what's outside of the synchronized block, it's outside of the synchronization. So it actually offers you more flexibility. And the other thing I wanted to show you is that you use synchronized, you can use it also with static methods. And that might be a little bit more tricky to understand, but not that bad at all. So you will see that's basically again the same thing. Synchronized works the same, but the monitor is different. So say you have a method D, you have a public static void D. And you might wonder what happens when you use a synchronized keyword here. So you see it's working, but what's that? Because yeah, you could say in the case of C and B, well, C is non-static, which means that it will refer always to the instance of the class, the instance that's behaving, because being a behavior, it will always be called from an instance, and that instance will always become you will always be able to refer to that instance using the this keyword from inside the method. And that's why also using synchronized refer to this and uses this as the monitor. But in case of a static method, that's not really how it works, because well, instead of having this, what else can you have? You cannot use this inside the method. Yeah, I can't say that this is similar to having this block, because as you can see, being inside the static method, the keyword is this cannot be used, because there is no instance behaving, as we discussed in the very first lessons of this stream. So what's in this case using synchronized here, and why is this working? Well, basically it turns out that using the synchronized keyword on a static method is basically similarly to using the instance of the class. And I'm not sure if this is basically something you know already. I will first write it. But when the class loader in Java, which is the mechanism of the Java virtual machine managing the classes, when it's loading the blueprint itself of the class, it actually creates an instance that refers to the blueprint itself. And we'll use that instance to work further with the class. So when we say we create an instance using class A, or we create an instance of class example 1, then the instance representing the class itself is used. And this instance is actually stored somewhere in a special memory zone that's called perm generation. The idea is that when you work with a synchronization on a static method, what will happen is that the synchronization is basically done using that instance representing the class itself, and that the JVM uses to refer to the blueprint itself. And you only have one instance of such a class per class loader, which is again the mechanism of the JVM managing the classes. This situation might become a little bit more complicated if you have multiple class loaders, but that's a situation that I consider outside of the fundamentals, so I won't get into the details now with what happens if you have multiple class loaders. So let's simplify our discussion now and refer to only having one class loader, which means that you only have one instance of the class in the perm generation, and you can refer to that instance with this syntax here: name of the class, then point and dot, or however you want to call it, and then the keyword class. When you refer to this, this is basically the instance of the blueprint itself. And when you use synchronized on a static method, it's basically the synchronization of the whole block of code of the method, like it was also in case of the non-static one. But the monitor is different, the monitor being in this case that only instance representing the blueprint and that Java uses then to create the instances of the class and refer to the prototype of that class itself. I will go into more details about this instance of the blueprint itself in a later lesson where we'll discuss Java Reflection. Java Reflection is another very powerful way in Java to refer to the instances, to manipulate the bytecode programmatically, and is used by, I would say, all the frameworks out there. So when you'll hear about Hibernate, Spring, any implementation of Java Enterprise Edition specifications, absolutely any kind of framework today in Java uses Reflection to manage instances, and it creates that so-called inversion of control way of managing your classes. So that's why in a future lesson I will go a little bit more into details and I will tell you more about this instance that's stored in the perm generation, but also we'll learn how to manipulate the bytecode using Java Reflection, which is strongly linked, I would say, to the knowledge of this class loader mechanism and how it works. So, but for the moment, the only thing you have to remember, at least for that OCP exam, is that you have only one object. Again, we take out the complex situation in which there are multiple class loaders, because that might be that can be a situation there, like a scenario, but it's a complex one, so I took it out, and it won't be anyway part of any of your OCP questions. So assuming you have only one class loader, which is in 99.99% of the cases true, then you have only one instance representing the class, and then synchronizing on that instance is basically what means using the synchronized keyword on the method itself as a modifier. So again, just to make sure that you understood, assume this is the synchronized block of code. Okay. And you can have multiple synchronized block of codes. When they are static, so this all three blocks of codes are static, and you use synchronized on them, and say this is actually called these are methods that are declared static in class A. So this is the name of the class here. There are three static methods. You can even name them if you'd like, M1, M2, and M3. They are three static methods, and I have used synchronized for them. So whenever your code will first time refer to class A, what happens is that somewhere in the memory, an instance will be created that's representing the class itself, and you can refer from your code to it as a point class. And this is somewhere in the memory, and it's only one instance that's representing that blueprint. So what actually means here is that all three methods that are synchronized, and because they are static, now they are all synchronized and will all refer to the same object, which is this object here. It's the same object that your application uses to create the instances of class A and work with the class itself, is basically representing your class. So if I do that, if I have three static methods and I use synchronized for all of them, they will be basically synchronized one with the other simply because they are using only one monitor. It's the same monitor they are using, is that only instance that was created by the class loader when referring to the class. That's basically how it's working. And fortunately, that's I would say everything that you need to know from using synchronized and the places where you can use synchronized. So this, together with what you've learned in the past couple of lessons, should make you a strong overview of where you can use it. Now, I know that implementing multi-threaded architectures is not easy, so maybe you still have a little bit of a fog in your mind if you just started with this. But from the point of view of the syntaxes, this is what you need to know. And now everything, of course, will get more clear with working with this this information that you've got here. But first of all, you need to learn the theory and know what does it mean to use synchronized here and there and in all the different possibilities. And that's why I have provided you, I've started in the past couple of lessons with a practical example where you have seen synchronized used and you've seen how it solves a problem of a race condition. And that now I have completed everything with showing you all the possible ways in which you will see synchronized use from the perspective of the syntax. And now basically being that they have the same functionality and the only thing that differs is the monitor itself. If you understood how a monitor works from the past lessons and now you know all the possible syntaxes, we can conclude that and say that you basically know everything that can be considered fundamental of synchronized. Now, I will end with discussing synchronized now and go to the next subject of today, which is deadlocks. A deadlock is also a situation, a problem that can occur in a multi-threaded architecture, and is the second one that we discussed basically, because the first one we've encountered in the past couple of lessons was race condition. Race condition was that situation in which multiple threads try to access and change one resource. So the same resource is accessed and more threads try to change it. So we say that they race to change that specific shared resource. And that's race condition. And you've learned that synchronization is a way to avoid race condition, because by synchronization, you simply specify that the threads should be working with a shared resource one after the other and not try to change it at the same time. That was with the race condition. But now we'll find out that there are basically more such situations that can cause trouble with multi-threaded architectures. And the second one we discuss, and again one that's very important because you'll find it in your OCP exam, but even if I don't wish you that, you might find it in real world scenarios. It's the deadlock, and the deadlock simply means that you have two or more threads. And because you did something wrong, or because the code is designed wrongly, say, you face a situation in which they wait one after the other. And because they wait one after the other, then the block simply stucks, the code simply stucks, and nothing goes further. So the application, your process completely blocks, and the threads cannot continue because each thread is basically waiting after another thread. This deadlock is more complex than this deadlock situation is much more complex than it appears, I had unfortunately the I had faced a lot of cases of deadlocks, and I had to investigate a lot of these situations, and I will teach you at some point in one of the future lessons also how to investigate deadlocks. It's not the purpose of the today's lesson, but at some point in one of the future lessons I will teach you how to use a profiler to find out that you have a deadlock and find out how can you solve it. There are a few very good profilers out there. I used to use JProfiler, but you have Java Flight Recorder as well, and that integrates very well with IntelliJ, for example. Knowing how to use a profiler, simply this very very simple application which we call Profiler is basically seeing and creating a map of all the threads that are executing at the same at some time, and it shows you when a thread is blocked and when it's running, and then you can find out if you have a deadlock. But before going into such details of how to solve deadlocks, first of all, let's understand how a deadlock, how it can occur, or at least try to find out the most straightforward way to implement a code that contains that has the possibility to go into a deadlock when executing it. And what I will show you now is basically that very simple example that you will find in the OCP 11 and the OCP generally in the OCP exam. If you know this, that's the only example in the questions of the OCP exam that refers to the deadlocks. So at least by learning this, you will know to answer the question in your OCP exam. But I don't only want that from you. I actually want to. I want you to understand also what the deadlock means, so that you can actually at some point investigate and solve such a problem when we will go into deeper with this subject. So in example 3 here, I will show you a very very simple example of code that at execution can cause a deadlock. And I will create example 3, which is a simple class, and I will create 2 methods, say m1 and m2. So you just assume that these methods are executed from 2 different threads, and then you have 2 objects that you use for some reasons. They are your monitors. So you have these 2 objects, and these are the objects you use as monitors. So we call them A and B. And say you have for some reason implemented a code where you synchronize on A, and then inside this synchronization block you do synchronize, you create another synchronized block where you synchronize on another monitor, which is B. And then you basically do something very similar in another method, but they are reversed, they are the other way around, like this. So I've added both of them to the same class just because I want you to have an overview, but you can now imagine that in a real world scenario, these 2 methods might be separated into 2 different classes, and then they are used by different threads. Why would this actually be a problem? So let's analyze a little bit this code and see what can happen. So you have multiple threads and they are calling these 2 methods. Because they are threads, they might call the 2 methods simultaneously or in any order, and we don't know precisely how will they be called basically. So to simplify the scenario, I will refer to only 2 of the threads, and let's say that one of them is called T1, and T1 managed somehow to enter method M1, and it's executing at the same time with another thread that's called T2, and T2 entered M2. So what can actually happen at this time is that T1 can proceed with the execution and arrive here between the start of the synchronized, of the first synchronized block that uses monitor A to do the synchronization, but before entering the second synchronized block here, which uses B. At the same time, so now no other thread actually can enter this synchronized block. If I would have a T3 here, T3 has to wait. It cannot enter anymore this block here because this block is already executed by T1. And remember, we discussed in the past lessons that when you have an active thread that obtained the lock for the monitor, then all the other threads have to wait until that one either is blocked, either will finish its execution. So that's why now any other block can, any other thread cannot execute this block here, because yeah, it's already taken by T1. But at the same time, T2 can proceed and can obtain the lock here and enter the first synchronized block inside M2. Why was it possible for T2 to enter this block here? Well, it's because it has a different monitor. So T1 entered the synchronized block here and obtained the lock on this monitor A. But monitor B is free now. It doesn't have any lock. There was no thread obtaining the lock for B. So what happened is that T2 obtained that lock, which actually means that if you'd have another thread here, now it cannot enter the synchronized block, because the synchronized block was already taken by T2. So unless T2 waits or will finish the execution of the block, no other thread can obtain the lock on B. And now is where the problem occurs, because T1 is obtained the lock for A and is somewhere between the start of the synchronized block and the start of this one. At some point, T1 will get on line 12. And what will T1 do when we'll start, when we'll reach the line 12 here of mine? So it simply happens that T1 cannot enter this synchronized block, because the synchronized block is synchronized on monitor B. So because T2 obtained the lock for B, there is no other thread that can enter a synchronized block with the same monitor. So T1 here will have to wait on line 12, and we will not be able to proceed to enter the synchronized block and eventually reach line 15, because the lock is already obtained for B by T2, which entered already the block, the synchronized block. But at the same time, T2 at some point, because it obtained the lock here, at some point will reach line 22, and T2 cannot obtain the access to the synchronized block, because the synchronized block inside here uses a monitor that is already taken by T1. So T1 obtained the lock, so no other thread now can continue on using this this block. So when T2 will reach line 22, we'll have to wait. And the question is now, when can T2 proceed and when can T1 proceed? It turns out that T1 can proceed now only when T2 will end its synchronized block, so reaching line 25. But T2 will never be able to reach line 25, because T2 cannot obtain the access to the synchronized block on line 22. And T2 is now waiting for T1 to reach line 15. But T1 will not be able to reach line 15 because it cannot enter the synchronized block on line 12, because it's taken by T2. And T2 at the same time cannot reach the end of its synchronized block, because it's waiting on line 22 here for the other one to finish. So basically T1 is waiting for T2 to finish, but cannot finish, because T2 cannot finish, it's waiting for T1. So T1 is waiting for T2, T2 is waiting for T1. Neither of them can go further, and neither of them will ever be able to finish their execution. So they are basically now locked, and they are waiting one after the other. And that's what a deadlock is. So you have a deadlock when you have at least two threads. There can be more, but you have at least two threads that are waiting one after the other. And in such a situation, neither of them can proceed. So you are stuck. So your process is stuck. That's a very very difficult to find problem, because first of all, you have to understand it's a deadlock, and then you have to use a profiler to see which are your threads in the application and which are their states. And then you have to find out to understand the logic and find out why one thread is waiting after the other. So what I have tried to present you here is basically the easiest way in which a deadlock can occur. Is maybe the only way in which you can theoretically present a deadlock. That's why this is also the only situation in which you will find deadlocks being referred from your OCP exam. So here became a deadlock between T1 and T2. But again, mind that this happens only because we have used these two monitors, these two resources on which we create a synchronization in reverse order. So with the same thing, I will create an example 4 for this. Example 4. Now I will copy the example 3 here. So let's copy it and change it. So if you have AB and then AB in the same order, then a deadlock doesn't occur anymore. So you actually have to be careful, because it doesn't have anything to do with the fact that I simply nested the two synchronized blocks. You might have in real world scenarios synchronized blocks nested in a correctly chosen fashion, in which they will never get to a deadlock. Like in the case of example 4 here, where the resources are in the same order, you won't get a deadlock. The reason for why in example 3 I got a deadlock is because of the order of the resources allowed me this space where if two threads occur at the same time, they get stuck. So at some point you can say that it's difficult to create a deadlock. It doesn't happen all the time. You have to get into a situation in which logically one thread needs to wait after the other. And at the same time, when you encounter such a situation, it's difficult to find out how it happened and profile your application, understand the logic, find out why did your threads go into that situation. And it doesn't have to be related with synchronized blocks at all as well. You will find out in the next lessons that there are also other ways in which you can do synchronizations, for example by using blocking objects like cyclic barriers, semaphores, read-write locks. And those can as well, if you don't use them properly, they can lead you to different situations in which you encounter deadlocks. So that's the idea of the deadlock, is that when you get into such a situation where one threads wait for the other and the other one waits for the first one, so they wait one after the other and your entire process gets stuck, then you can say you have a deadlock, and you have to find out why this situation was created and then change your code such that you correct the problem, the code designing problem. I don't know, because this is more of a code design problem if you get into such a situation. So this is basically the idea with the deadlocks as well. So I hopefully managed to show you everything that's important to know about both the synchronized keyword and the deadlocks. It's already a lot of time has passed, and I only have 10 more minutes, and that's not quite enough time to discuss very much about executor services. So what I will do because I don't have enough time. I will take it out from the today's title and I will start with executor services and as a new chapter with the next lesson, because it doesn't make sense to get you confused with all this at the same time. So at least we can say that in these three lessons where we discuss threads, you've learned up to now how to use the thread class, the runnable interface. We discussed about the synchronized keyword, we discussed about wait, notify, and notify all, and now we have also seen all the syntactical ways in which you can use the synchronized keyword, and we discussed also about deadlocks, so we have covered what a race condition is and what a deadlock is. And regarding to deadlocks, again, I will come back in one of the future lessons where I will try to show you how to use also a profiler and understand what a profiler is. At that point, we will discuss maybe more on how to solve a deadlock, which is a much more complex subject. But for the moment, it's enough, I would say, at least if you understand what a deadlock is and if you remember that nested synchronized blocks situation that you will find in your OCP exam. So another question, do synchronization issues occur with advanced frameworks like Spring? Well, yes, it might happen. Now, I'm not sure if the question is if they can happen inside Spring. I didn't see such a situation in which the framework itself causes deadlock if you use threads and leave the framework manage them. But Spring allows you as well to create your own threads, and if you create your own threads and do your own synchronization, it doesn't actually matter if you use Spring or another framework, you can get into the same situations. If you use Spring to manage your threads, but you use synchronization, you implement your own synchronization in the tasks that you provide Spring to execute, then again, yes, it can happen, because Spring will only, what Spring does, it's only covering some of your code. It basically, in most of the cases, uses executor services behind. It's the very next subject that we need to discuss. Like thread pools and executor services. So all the problems that you can get with executor services, and that those can be also synchronization problems, they can happen with Spring as well, because it is you who provide the tasks. And if in the tasks you do the synchronization and you do it wrong, then it's not Spring's job to take care of that. Spring will only try to execute the task. If the task is poorly synchronized and it causes a deadlock, yes, it will happen. But what I didn't see any situation in which, say, I use the reactive approach implementation of Spring and I have problems with the very inside implemented threads of Spring that deals with the, I don't know, reactive approach. That's something I didn't see. That's because in most of the cases, Spring is a very solid implementation, and most of its components are really mature and tested before they are going out. And insides of the framework itself, I would say they are solid enough that you won't ever see situations like problems with multi-threading architectures that come from inside the framework itself. You will maybe get problems with Spring applications only when you yourself create the tasks and then just provide them to be executed by Spring, and then it's your problem because it's your tasks. It's not a Spring problem. But problems with inside the Spring, no, I would say no. You shouldn't. I didn't see that in 15 years. You'll probably not see that in the next versions either. Hopefully, I'm an optimistic person, so hopefully we won't get into a situation in which we'll see such problems in Spring. thank you very much for the question. So with that being said, if there are no other questions, I would call it close for today. And thank you very much again for being here with me. Thank you very much for joining this live event. And let's continue in the next lesson with the executor services.
And that's when we start discussing about the high-level frameworks of multi-threaded architectures. Thank you again and have a great time for study.